Today we're going to look at the Philips Coreline Tempo range of LED floodlights.
That's not a floodlight, Gary. This is a floodlight. I swear Crocodile Dundee said something like that in a film once.
Okay, I've got the small. What have you got?
This is the XL, but it's the Coreline range. We've looked at that quite a bit on the channel before. We looked at the high bay lights. We looked at the Interact Pro control system and some of those Coreline lights that work with that. This flood lighting range, that continues. But when I think Coreline, Gary, what have we learned about it so far?
I'm thinking quality and ease of installation, Gordon.
Exactly, and we'll start with the easiest bit the electrician worries about. It comes with some rubberized cable on it and a simple connector. On this version, it's a connector. On the one you've got there, Gary,
yes,
it's an inline termination.
It is.
Because obviously that's a lot lighter than this unit here. So that's the easy bit. But some of the features we immediately recognise that we've spoken before is the service tag.
Okay, so let's
spin that over there. So we have made a video about the service tag. That's great for anyone who's looking at the long-term maintenance. Check out that video if you haven't seen it. With this, they offer some spare stickers.
Okay, so spare stickers. I suppose you could leave one in the manual and the handover documents that you have. Where else could you leave the sticker, Gordon?
Well, with this, obviously this is a huge amount of light comes from this product. I'd suggest it's going to end up quite high up in the air. The last thing you want to be doing is going up in the air to find the service tag to come back down again. So you get that spare sticker possibly put in the bottom of the column if it's on a column, or yeah, the fuse distribution board if on there. So that's the first features we're used to seeing on the Coreline product.
What about the optics in here? Because they look completely different to what I'm used to seeing, Gordon.
You're right, Gary, because normally what would you see on a floodlight? You go down to the wholesale count, there's lots of floodlights available. People buy by wattage and you've got this yellow square in the middle and some metalwork. There isn't actually much optical performance going on there. This is different with the Coreline range, and that's probably, when you start thinking about specifying floodlights, that makes a huge difference. Not in terms of, you know, thinking about things like light pollution, but where that light goes.
Okay.
We'll look at regulations a little bit further on. Everyone loves a regulation. But two optical footprints come with your one there, your smaller one in this large one, described as symmetrical and asymmetrical.
Okay, I'll let you continue on with your descriptions now.
Okay, symmetrical, evenly distributed light from all sides of the product. Asymmetrical is quite useful. So most of the light actually comes forward.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's useful. So say you were mounting this on a building wall.
Okay.
And you don't actually want the light going behind you, because that's wasted light in most instances.
So that would be light being thrown back to the surface, the wall, etc. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you want the light to be thrown outwards.
You want outward. And think, you know, if you're lighting a car park or possibly a sports area with these larger units, that's what you'd want. You'd put them around the edge of the pitch or the tennis court or whatever, and the light would project onto the area.
Right.
And you know, you will still get some light going backwards, but that's possibly not where you want. So that's asymmetric optics. It's a huge design advantage. And obviously, remember, wasted light is also wasted energy.
Yeah.
So if you've got that kind of that distribution, it is a way of saving energy if you correctly design your installation.
And talking about energy, obviously that is a very large unit. It's the XL, as you told me already. What's the power rating of that?
So this is a 250 watt unit at 36,000 lumens.
Pretty bright then.
So, well, you're down at 38 watts and 4,200 lumens.
Okay.
So obviously for different applications. So you're probably sort of general lighting. You might like some signage with that, possibly some landscape lighting, where this is for those large car parks, some sports lighting applications, things like that.
Okay, and that power rating there, is there any way that we can perhaps reduce that power rating, dim it down?
Okay, so that's possibly something people don't necessarily think about when you think about floodlights, is the fact that you can actually dim them. Now, there's a few reasons you might want to do that. If you're designing a lighting installation, you're probably going to reference the SLL handbook.
Right, okay, let's bring that in, yes.
If anyone wants guidance on actually where you get light levels for applications from, that book is peppered with applications. You know, this might end up on a loading bay, and in there you'll get some guidance on the lux level you need to achieve, uniformity, so difference between minimum, maximum output in an area. And that's done for an application. So a loading bay, I'd suggest, what you're doing in a loading bay?
Usually moving items around from one place to another.
Yeah, exactly. Loading a lorry, something like that, people actually doing their work.
Yes.
And getting the right light level for that. but perhaps there's a time of the day when it's not being used.
Okay, so maybe everyone's gone home and maybe security guards are patrolling that area, don't need the same level of lights.
Yeah, so you can, in that instance, reduce the light level down.
Right.
And obviously it's a different application at that time of day, and that is a great way of saving energy. So let's just have a look at what happens when we do that.
Okay, let's bring that in.
What I've got here, Gary, I've connected the floodlight to this programmable power meter. And what we can see on the display, there's our incoming line voltage, around about 230 volts as you'd expect, current being consumed, and the power, so nearly 250 watts, which is the rating of the unit. Let's just check the power factor while we're here, just check no one's been fibbing on the data sheet. 0.98, which is a good thing, so we're not far off unity on that. I've also got a DALI dimmer that's connected to the floodlight, so this is five wire connection to the unit itself. Our line neutral CPC, and then two wires for that DALI connection. So I'm now going to start dialing the power down, and we should see the light start to dim.
So we're at full brightness at the minute.
Full brightness and full power. So I'll start taking that down, and you'll see the light slowly start to dim as well. Keep on going, so there we're down at around 30 watts, so we're getting towards sort of 10% of our initial power, so that represents a significant power saving, and obviously we still have a significant amount of light coming out of the unit as well.
Okay, you've got some blue caps there on the side of yours, and I've got some dials on the side of me. Can you just explain to me what they are, Gordon?
Okay, so we spoke briefly about optics. So if you're using optics, you're probably going to do quite a detailed design study of the application.
Yes.
And obviously you can adjust your application in terms of where the light's going by slightly tilting the fitting.
Right.
You probably just wouldn't do that on site. You'd probably do that as a design thing. So say you, in your design, you'd say, I'm going to set it to, say, 20 degrees up from that horizontal point.
Right.
There's some useful markings on the side, which you can see there.
So you lock that into position. Obviously, again, it would be left in the handbook, left behind. And then obviously, if it ever got knocked or hit, you'd know that you've got to return it to the appropriate angle, Gordon?
Yes, that's it, exactly. And that's the same on the smaller one as well. That's cast into the aluminium.
Yes, it is. Let's have another little look at that then. Yeah, you're right, it is. So it's just there on there, so you can set the angle on that one as well. Nice touch, very nice touch.
So both robust units, you know, common different, completely different size ranges, lumen package outputs, both efficient, you know, we're over 100 lumens per watt, 75,000 hours alive to L80 on there, and this up to 100,000 hours in the XL range.
Right, I'm IP65, you're
And this is IP66, so again, very similar. Common glass front, which is a good thing, so, you know, glass tends to be self-cleaning. There's nowhere for dust to build up on that, so you keep that good lumen output throughout the life of the product.
So these fittings have got an incredible amount of electronics in them, Gordon. Has there any protection measures been built in?
Yeah, again, something people don't necessarily think about. External installation, probably remote from a building, cable lengths.
Yeah.
You think about surge protection coming into the building, but obviously forget that actually those cables going out to floodlights, these tend to be up on the, you know, tall poles, things like that. Surge protection built in to protect from those atmospheric transients that can happen in any electrical installation, but particularly important in floodlights.
That's a nice little touch again, isn't it? They're all built in.
Yeah, well, you're paying for reliability. You want to make sure that obviously carries through the whole duration of your installation. I'll speak to your Philips representative to talk about some of the other optical versions available and some of the special protection for swimming pool and marine salt environments.
We're always interested in your comments. Are you currently fitting any industrial or commercial style LED lights? What's your go-to lighting product? Have you fitted this range before from Philips? The Coreline Tempo range. If you have, we'd love to hear your comments, and we'll try and get back to as many as we can.